Hello, a warm welcome to all of you, and welcome at Cosent's Bright Beat Solutions, where we will dive into the incredibly versatile sugar beet. We'll do that in a bit, but first I'm going to help you get set for this next hour. My name is Esther van Rijswijk. I will talk you through this hour and I will introduce you to our guests in a bit. But first I would like you to realize that we would really be happy if you all use the chat. You can see it on the right side of your screen. Some of you have already logged in. Please put in your name there. Also use your surname if you have questions that you really want an answer to. So we're going to be answering most of the questions in the coming weeks. In maybe a week you will have answers, but some of them we will answer right now in the next hour. But again, to get back to you, we need your name. So if you want an answer, put your full name in there, including your surname. And to see if all this is working, I would like to ask you to put in the chat right now the first thing that comes to mind when I say sugar beet. So often you start thinking too much right now already. Don't do that. Just write down in the chat the first thing that comes to mind when I say sugar beet. All those answers will be coming in here in a bit. There's a bit of a delay, so we will have to wait every time a little bit to see your answers, but we will get them. There's a second way in which we would like to get in touch with you, and that's the poll function. You see on the bottom of your screen, you see a question emerging there, and it's a question that you can vote for. So there's a dark red button that you can press, and then you can vote. And the question, just to test if all this is working for you, is what is your relationship with Cosent Beet Company? What's your relationship with Cosent Beet Company? Are you a customer or a partner? That would be A. Or maybe a supplier or a transporter. Maybe you are a grower, or maybe you are something else. So if you give the right answer, and if you can't find it, bottom of the screen, red button. You need to press the vote button. Good. If you're all set then, I would like you to introduce to you Paul Mesters, the CEO of Cosent Beet Company. This is your show. We're in your house.
So is it. And everybody, a warm welcome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I will just help everybody to get through this. We are here live. That means we are all, you are tested negative, I'm tested negative. It's all safe. And we will be talking about this beet in a minute. But first, in this crazy year, how are you doing?
Well, yeah, it's of course COVID time, and COVID time I think had a very big impact on everybody's personal life, but it also has a big impact on Cosent Beet Company. We had a tough year, difficult, in 2020, but we managed to stay in the black figures, so we're also very proud of the result that we achieved with all our employees, so that we are still in the black figures.
So what did COVID do to sugar consumption?
It certainly had the effect that there was a lower sugar consumption because of the lockdown. The lockdown certainly affected the out-of-home sales, so people who went out to restaurants, etc., was much less. And thus, also in Southern Europe, less vacation, less holidays. So also there was less sugar consumption.
We eat most of our sugar outside of the house. We don't get the ice creams
Still, most of it is at home.
Yeah, but a big chunk.
Still, a big part of the business was affected by, let's say, the out-of-home consumption.
And we don't compensate for that.
Okay. No.
You are the chat guy today, because
Correct.
You know best what questions really need to be answered right here in this next hour.
Yeah.
As I said, all the other questions will also be answered if people put in their name and surname. So, people at home, take your chance. You can chat directly with Paul. Put all your questions forward. We will be happy to answer them. Let's have a look at the poll. People just filled it in. And so the question was, what is your relationship with Cosent Beet Company? And as you guys can see at home as well, we see that over half of the people at home, Paul, are customers or partners.
Yeah.
And that's funny because we just did one in Dutch as well, and we had a totally different audience, which is great. So we can have two great shows. 18% of you is a supplier or a transporter. There's no growers there. They're mostly Dutch, obviously. And there's about 28% of you is doing something else. If you want to share what that is, or if you want to make sure we know you're here, don't hesitate. Throw it into the chat and we'll see it and use it. Paul, why are we doing this show? This is the audience we were hoping for, obviously.
Yes.
Why are we standing here?
Yeah, we had a big event planned last year that had to do with our name change. Unfortunately, that event was cancelled and postponed because of COVID. And then again postponed and postponed and postponed. So then we decided we need another event. And that's this event today.
Yeah. 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 So the name change initially was the reason we were doing this. Has that all landed? Does everybody?
The name change has landed very well, but we still believe that the reasons why, the purpose, that still can be improved, and we still have to talk about why we changed the name.
Yeah. Yeah. So why did you change the name?
Yeah, that's the obvious question. we've seen for a long time we had a Dutch name, a very good Dutch name, but it was very difficult to pronounce outside of the Netherlands. And then if we look at our business has evolved with almost 50% of our volume produced is sold outside of the Netherlands. So most of our account managers today are also often traveling in the EU to, of course, visit customers, etc. And also in our product line, we used to be sugar only, and now.
At Cosin Beet Company, it's all about the beet, the source of inspiration for a sustainable future for more than 100 years. The first Dutch sugar beet cooperative was founded by a group of arable farmers in 1899. Since then, we have grown into an international organization with more than 8,000 members, farming some 75,000 hectares of sugar beet. Initially, we were purely a sugar producer, but today we do much, much more. We are working every day to become the greenest, most innovative, and most successful beet processor in the world. Research is helping us achieve this ambition, and it begins on the farm. Our beet advisory system analyzes crop data so that our agricultural service can provide the growers with tailored advice. We call this smart farming, and we are the European leader in it. In the Cosin.
Are we getting there?
We are on a very interesting journey. I think that from a very traditional sugar producer, we are now at the forefront of being an efficient and low energy using sugar producer. So our carbon footprint for the sugar is one of the lowest in the world. But next to that, we of course discovered that we are sitting on a very versatile product with a very low carbon footprint, and it can be used for many other applications outside of food. So you have to think of biomaterials, bioplastics, so everything where today we use fossil oil. But next to that, also the beet itself has much more components than sugar only. For example, in the beet leaf is also protein.
Yeah.
And what you see today, for example, in society is a big shift from animal protein to plant protein.
Yeah. We will discuss that extensively in a minute with Olaf. But you've also brought some stuff. It's not just protein and food.
No,
what's this?
I especially bought for you a hand gel, liquid. Yeah, a liquid soap. It contains beet fiber and fiber from the chicory root.
Is it a soap or is it?
It's really a soap, a liquid soap, including beet fiber and fiber from the chicory root. So it's a nice combination approach because our sister company, Sensus, produces the chicory fiber.
Ah, well, thank you so much. I'm going to try it in a bit. I hope the other guys will be bringing me presents as well.
Yes, I'm sure of that.
Well, you already start to mention all those products, all those other ways of using the beet, which is basically what this Bright Beet Solutions afternoon is
example,
all about.
For example, the tabletop here
also
is made from dried beet pulp.
It's everywhere. I can't touch anything anymore now without thinking it's probably a beet.
Yeah, and at the height of the COVID time, maybe this one is also interesting. Everybody, of course, start using the antibacterial gels based on alcohol. And our factory in Germany, Cosen Beet Company Germany, is a large producer of the alcohol which goes into these hand gels, which we all now use because of COVID.
Wow. Amazing, amazing. We will start this afternoon. Paul's here all afternoon to answer the chat questions. Please put them forward. But we will go on to our next guest in a bit. His name is Olaf van Baal and he's the Chief Innovation Officer. He has been with Cosen Beet Company for a really long time. And he went all the way from developing sugar packages or sugar packs to, well, some of these amazing things we just mentioned and that we will be talking about in a bit. He's here in a bit. First, we're going to watch a small video together. Have a look.
At Cosen Beet Company, it's all about the beet, the source of inspiration for a sustainable future for more than 100 years. The first Dutch sugar beet cooperative was founded by a group of arable farmers in 1899. Since then, we have grown into an international organization with more than 8,000 members, farming some 75,000 hectares of sugar beet. Initially, we were purely a sugar producer, but today we do much, much more. We are working every day to become the greenest, most innovative and most successful beet processor in the world. Research is helping us achieve this ambition, and it begins on the farm. Our beet advisory system analyzes crop data so that our agricultural service can provide the growers with tailored advice. We call this smart farming, and we are the European leader in it. In the Cosen Innovation Centre, we work on product development, process technology, analysis and research. Cosen Beet Company is a member of Royal Cosen, a forward-looking cooperative. Together, we are turning the enormous potential of plants into innovative and practical everyday solutions. We use all the components of the beet to provide solutions for food, animal feed, green fertilizers, soil to improve farmland, soil to build roads and strengthen dikes, and green gas. We transport sugar to our customers in trucks that run on our own green gas. Because we don't produce any waste, the beet is 100% circular. Sugar beet is a unique source of bio-based solutions. We use the beet as an ingredient in detergents, dishwasher tablets, personal care, packaging materials and disinfectant hand gels. In the future, we even want to provide the raw materials to make green chemicals and bioplastics. We are already producing protein from beet leaves to meet the growing demand for vegetable proteins. It will be clear that sustainability is in our DNA. We deliver solutions that meet the challenges facing society and are working on a sustainable future. Thanks to our passion, we are moving towards a circular economy and getting the best out of the beet. Bright Beet Solutions.
We had enough time for you to quickly walk over here. Olaf van Baal, the Chief Innovation Officer. Welcome. As I said, you've been with Cosen for a really long time, ever since
2004.
So you have seen how the company has developed.
Yeah, definitely.
You started with sugar packages or developing them, the tiny ones, the sugar bags?
No, the big one, industrial.
The big ones.
I worked in the sugar factory over here in Dinteloord, where we are today.
Yeah.
And I worked in the packaging department.
Okay, and obviously you can spend a lot of time thinking about these packages. We will talk about them later as well. Paul, why did we invite Olaf here today? Why do we need him?
Yeah, because we are very much interested in these new innovations. We split the company in basically two activities. Mm-hmm. One is to be a very efficient and green sugar producer, and the other one is to try to make new products out of the sugar beet. Yeah. So for that, we really decided we need a dedicated department and a dedicated guy who's going to work on those new applications and new products.
The dedicated chief new or chief innovation officer.
Yeah,
so what does that mean? You're sitting in behind your desk all day thinking about, okay, what else can we do?
Yeah, I don't do it myself, but the challenge for me and a lot of my colleagues, of course, is to come up with new opportunities from the sugar beet to make money, to create value. Well, in the meantime, we'll also do something back for society. Yeah? We address some of the challenges that are in society today. Yeah.
Like what?
Yeah, there are a lot of challenges. And I brought also a picture with me just that summarizes all together. We see a lot of challenges in the world, like, for example, a growing world population that needs to be fed. We see a more demand towards healthy foods, especially, of course, also in Corona time. We see the transition, like Paul already mentioned, from a consumption of animal protein to more and more plant-based protein. And of course, climate change is one challenge we all know, I guess.
But it's quite something, though, this picture, isn't it?
Yeah.
So you're saying the beet can actually help solve world problems.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah. We from the solution from the beet, we can help solve these challenges. And that's by means of our bright beet solutions.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's definitely something else than just finding new way of packet to put new bags to put your sugar in. So what do you think the Olaf that came in here almost 17 years ago would not have believed his older version would be doing right now?
Yeah, I think in the factory I saw a lot of sugar, of course, and a lot of sugar beets pass by. But what I would never have guessed that today we are working on sugar beet leaves. And we are extracting.
Back then they were just thrown away or what?
No, they were left on the land. So as a guy in the factory, I never saw sugar beet leaves. Hmm. So I could not have imagined that I would be working with them today. Mm-hmm. And what we do, we extract protein out of it. And it's a very special protein because it has very specific properties and can be used in a lot of applications. And I brought one application as an example also today.
Show me. Oh.
It's about meat replacers. And this protein that we have that really puts all the ingredients of such replacers together so that it really sticks together and that it looks very nice, but it also tastes very nice. But the most important is that it replaces chicken egg protein. And by that sense, this protein really helps to become 100% vegan.
So these are going to be chicken burgers that you're going to be made, well, plant-based chicken kind of burgers that
meat replaces, but 100% plant-based and not partly based from
plant
animals.
Plant burgers.
Yeah, I know, but I don't know why we keep calling them burgers. I mean, it's something new, but and are we already eating beet in burgers?
Not yet, because that's a long process. You have to go to EU authorities, EFSA, to get the protein out of the beet leaf approved. So that takes about 2 years.
And
so
it's there, your whole dossier with
everything regarding food safety, etc., has all been done. Yeah.
And it takes 2 years.
Yeah.
When did you apply?
Last December, I think.
Okay, so we have a long way to go. So this has been covered then. What else?
What else? Well, what I mentioned also, healthy food is a very important trend.
I think you brought me. I already got one present. But
please take it. No problem.
And what is it?
There's sugar beet in there.
I already mentioned that we just did a Dutch version. So, I have tasted it.
Surprise.
But I will show you again that it is very drinkable.
It basically, the biggest component or ingredient is sugar beet puree.
Yeah.
Just like a banana puree, which you would make at home. So we take the whole sugar beet and make puree from it. And that's the main ingredient in this product.
Yeah, exactly.
And I, of course, you guys are paying me to be here, but I really like it. You
that's
don't
good
pay
to
me
yeah.
to say
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
And is this, it's sweet, obviously.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So
yes.
How healthy is this? How much sugar is there in there?
It's 20% sugar beet,
mm-hmm.
so 20% with 17% of sugar, mm-hmm. so not so much. There's also some red beet in there and apple juice. But the nice thing is that from the sugar beet, also the fibers. The proteins are in that smoothie. Yeah. So it makes it a lot more healthy, of course. Yeah.
Okay. So that's as far as the food is concerned. Yeah. We've already mentioned other things that we
applications,
that you can use
yeah.
it for.
Yeah, outside of food, there's a lot of possibilities.
Like
washing liquids, yeah, exactly, yeah, detergents. Mm-hmm. And what we do is also the sugar beet is a great basis for non-food applications. And by working on that, we can really contribute to the challenge of climate change, because the sugar beet is a real champion of getting the CO2 out of the air and fixing it in the beet.
Mm-hmm.
And when you then make materials like
this you one. Brought some.
So if you then make materials you can use in washing detergents, you're much more sustainable than when you make them out of oil.
Yeah.
And maybe to explain a little bit on what is...
What is it doing in there?
Yeah.
Is it actually cleaning my clothes or...?
it helps. It helps. But the main function is that we get fibers out of the sugar beet pulp,
mm-hmm.
very tiny fibers, and it's a thickening agent for this detergent.
Okay.
So it helps the perfume balls that are in this this detergent as well to make sure that they don't
and are those the same as in here or this is something
I think
completely different
the same or maybe additional ones
So detergent,
yep,
obviously. What else?
I got another one for you. And this is all about packaging. If you look closer then you will see the tiny specks. And that's also due to the sugar beet.
This is not entirely white or blue.
No,
yeah, I see
no.
the specks.
Yeah, so...
So there's beet not only in the sugar inside, but also in the paper.
Yeah, also in the paper. And so we produce paper from sugar beet pulp and we already sell it. So we're making money out of that. And that's great. But additionally, we are also making our packaging more sustainable. Because sugar beet pulp is more sustainable than... virgin wood fibers, where normally this kind of paper is made from.
Okay, I think we have a question on that, don't we?
A
poll question. So if you check out the question in your screen and then you can vote for it, the question that we have is, what percentage of the environmental footprint would sugar beet pulp in comparison with wood fiber? I think I misread it here something. What percentage would sugar beet pulp cut in relation, in comparison with wood fiber?
Exactly.
Well, you see it in front of you, so it's written there correctly. But what percentage of the environmental footprint would sugar beet cut in comparison with wood fiber? You're going to give us the answer in a bit.
Yep.
First, we're going to make sure that everybody has the time to fill it in. Paul, how about questions? Are there questions coming in? Are they going wild out there?
Yeah, we had a question of where can I buy that liquid detergent?
Oh.
You have to take a ticket to Spain because
it's Spanish,
exactly,
what we see.
It's sold
there.
At a Spanish supermarket, a big one, Mercadona. They are one of the leaders in Spain.
But why? Why Spain? How did you end up in a Spanish?
Yeah,
is that a long story?
It's a long story.
Okay.
And I saw another remark was sugar tax, an interesting one. Also there we can have long discussions. We as a company believe in a government approach where you take the whole food and lifestyle.
Yeah, but maybe we should
introduce
the debate a little bit. It was probably because I was asking how much sugar is in here. And obviously, in many countries, some already have a sugar tax.
Yeah.
In the UK?
In the UK.
And where else?
People are not not a better BMI than in the Netherlands in the UK.
So the idea is to lower sugar intake by taxing it.
Yeah.
And you were explaining,
yeah.
you were reacting to that. Is
yes.
that a good idea?
Yes.
No.
So we say no.
Yeah.
We say no. It's a food and lifestyle approach of a government where you have to take the whole food system and have to promote vegetables and fruits without added tax, for example, but also lifestyle and more moving. Because if you start with a tax, it ends nowhere. You can have tomorrow a PlayStation tax because mm-hmm. we all know people are sitting too long behind the PlayStation, And then the day after you can have a fish and chip stacks, because we all know fish and chips is nice to eat, but also not very healthy. So the end of, you could have an enormous amount of taxes if you start.
You could tax everything we really like, basically.
Yes.
Because obviously some of the things we really like aren't so healthy.
Yeah.
But then what? Because it is
and
a also problem.
The effect is unknown. You start with a tax where the effect is unknown. We only know that people will, consume less sugar, but we don't know what they compensate with.
Yeah.
So it could be completely other products. And thus, there is no study in the world which shows that sugar tax lowers the BMI, for example.
Okay, but so you're not saying that sugar can be part of a not so healthy diet, but you're saying if you want to get people more healthy,
you need
don't just blame it on the sugar.
You need a holistic approach.
Yeah. Okay.
Lifestyle, then you need really.
I get that.
Yeah.
Let's go to the chat question or the poll question, because we still owe people an answer. I can tell you, Olaf, that about 10% of the people at home said, 14% thinks it's only 10% difference, a cut. 28% thinks it's 80. So those are the long tails. Which is the right answer?
80%.
80%.
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
So you cut the footprint by using sugar beet instead of wood.
Yeah, instead of virgin wood fiber, yeah.
Okay.
Correct.
But that does not mean that this is 80% more, but this is not all.
No.
The paper is, you didn't take out all the
wood. No, there's still 80% wood and 20% sugar beet pulp.
Yeah.
So that reduces the footprint, the environmental impact of the paper itself with 16%, which is still very significant, of course.
But it's really a lot better than using wood. Is it competing with wood in other applications or
also packaging, of course, definitely. So you can make paper, but we're also studying a lot of other applications, like cardboard boxes, molded packaging, etc. So there's a lot.
And the tabletops
again. Definitely. So a lot of possibilities also being investigated. Yeah.
Okay, good. You did bring us another.
Yeah, I did.
Picture,
I did.
I think.
And that's also to tell that of course innovation you don't do alone. We do that together within Cosen Beet Company, but also within Cosen, in the Cosen Innovation Center, that's indicated over here, together with Cosen Innovation colleagues, Cosen R&D, but also with other Cosen companies. And we do it in the plant positive way. So we do it together with the plant being in the center of everything, and positively contributing to society. So that's what joins us within Cosen.
The plant positive way.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, nice, huh?
Paul, what's happening in the chat?
In the chat is a question regarding, can you commoditize sugar beet so that they become year-round available and enable the use for non-food products? I think
you have to explain to me. They are not obviously not the year all year round.
No, it's a crop like every food staple crop, corn, sugar beet, wheat mostly is harvested. So it's not year round available.
It is available. It's not
available.
Taken off. What's behind this question?
I think behind this question is, can you legitimize non-food use? So first generation. I think we are very efficient in a very high yield. So if you compare us with other crops, we get the most energy from the land by using the beet. And then Olaf can probably confirm that first and second generation doesn't say anything about greenhouse gas savings.
No, I agree. So we have, I already said that we have the most efficient crop to get carbohydrates out, to make other materials from. And that's much more efficient than, for example, when you take second generation, like straw or wood or whatever, because you need a lot of energy to get the sugars out of those streams to be able to make products out of
there. The beet is easy to
And the
subtract.
Beet, you just have to heat them up a little bit, and then the sugar comes out
and
of it already.
Give you everything.
So it's very efficient in growth and very efficient in processing, so much more sustainable. Yeah.
Okay, is there anything you would add to the answer that to the question that was just asked? So it's not available year round.
Yeah, but what is available year-round is our sugar beet pulp, which is a basis for the detergent and for the paper, and of course also our sugar. And from sugar we can make anything that you can also make out of oil, but much more sustainable, and we can do that year-round.
Okay. Other questions we want to pick up?
I think, as maybe to do with this question we already discussed. Will these innovations hold back the production of sugar?
So will you end up completely letting go of the sugar?
No, I don't think so.
How is it divided right now?
Now, of course, let's say 80% of the plant ends up as sugar, mm-hmm. and the rest in other feed applications or in green gas applications, etc. But the question behind it is maybe on the longer term, we see sugar consumption going down, mm-hmm. Because of lifestyle, health, etc. So the image of sugar. So we predict that sugar consumption per person will go down. And then we can use that sugar which becomes available, because mm-hmm. we eat less sugar, for all the bio-based applications that Olaf is working on.
And in addition to that, we also, year by year, especially our growers, they are becoming more efficient. So where normally we used to grow on 110,000 acres of land, now we're growing the same amount of sugar on only 80,000 hectares. So also there, the efficiency is becoming better and better. And that also helps, of course, in this discussion.
Clearly so.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for being
you're welcome.
With us, Olaf van Baal. Olaf wants to use the whole beet, and he's looking for all kinds of ways to do this. We were talking about paper and detergent and many other protein, maybe being the most exciting one for the moment. The next video shows us a bit of the process of the packaging. And if you have a good look at the beginning, you will already see our next guest. In a bit, we will be talking to him, to Andries Olie, and he's the guy that made Kozum produce enough green gas to provide energy for small village. Let's have a look.
We weten gebruiken we alles van de suikerbiet.
Dus vandaag spreken we met Arno over de suikerbietenpil.
Nou, als we de suiker uit de biet gehaald hebben, blijft er ongeveer 20% over. En dat is dan pulp. Wij noemen dat perspulp. Wordt hoofdzakelijk verkocht in de diervoeding. Het is een heel mooi product. Er zit 26% droge stof in. En koeien die eten dat heel graag. Het is eiwitrijk. Dus het overgrote deel wordt in die markt afgezet. Nou, diervoeding, daar wordt het dus voor verkocht. Maar we kijken ook naar andere toepassingen. En dat is bijvoorbeeld de vezels die we uit die pulp gaan halen. Die kunnen gebruikt worden om papier en eventueel verpakkingsmiddelen mee te maken. Nou, dat wordt nu ook al gedaan en we zijn ook verder aan het kijken naar andere toepassingen. In de markt zijn we dat aan het onderzoeken, dat in de homecare producten bijvoorbeeld, dat we ook vezels van pulp toe kunnen gaan passen. En dat zou voor ons natuurlijk een hele mooie verbreding van de afzetmarkt betekenen. Een andere optie die we ook al nog hebben is dat we de perspulp kunnen vergisten in onze eigen vergistingsinstallaties. En dan maken we uiteindelijk van deze pulp maken we dan proefgas.
Yes, and here we have Andries Olie. We just saw you with wearing a different suit in the film. Kozum wants to be the most innovative, and that's we just heard. You are here to show us that it can be the greenest ones.
Yep.
Paul is making sure all this adds up to the most successful one, we hope. Now, Paul and Olaf have been with Kozum since, I think it was 2004. What were you doing back then?
2004, I was a policeman, actually.
A policeman?
So, yes, yes. And, well, now we're into plants, but back then I was into hennep plants and busting these people. But there are different plants, as you can imagine. It was a great time. And, I wanted to study, and I studied nutrition and health, and I ended up here. And, I think it's a very nice company to work for. And if you look at all the green things we do, and all the sustainability issues we tackle, I think it was a good move.
It was a good move, because you're now the sustainability manager at Royal Cosun. Before, up until quite recently, you were doing all that for a Cosun Beet company.
Exactly.
So you know a lot, and it all works together, obviously.
Absolutely.
We just talked about, with Olaf, about the trends in the world that you want to pick up on using the beet. Now we will be talking about sustainability.
Yep.
What are we talking about when we're talking about beets and sustainability?
Yeah, well, I think we should go to a completely circular economy. And I think the sugar beet really fits in well. And of course, Paul and Olaf already mentioned a lot of interesting topics. But if we look at this beet, and I always get a smile on my face when I see it. But like they said, the harvest is enormous. So there's no other crop where you can have so much, for example, energy in the form of sugar, but also plant-based protein, animal feed, all these innovations, bioplastics, you name it, we have no waste.
So you guys claim you are smiling more than most. I mean, if I talk to, I don't know, somebody who grows potatoes, he'll be smiling as well, or what?
Yes.
Sure.
But you guys
in our
are
group, in our group is also Avico, and they of course they are in the business of French fries, so they smile about potatoes.
So what are you when you are together having a drink? Why are you saying now the beet's better than the potato?
I think both crops are really good, but if you look, for example, at the energy content and how the sugar beet fits to the sustainable development goals.
Then it's really something special.
Absolutely.
You're claiming we can do more than the potato.
But for a farmer, for example, potato is more important in the income of a farmer.
So that's why we are quickly going to the sustainable development goals now, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it fits well. They're presented here. But for example, if you look at zero hunger, and we already mentioned the caloric content. But I think
we don't have
nice
to explain to anybody what a sustainable development
I think
goals
most
are.
People know, but maybe it's developed by the United Nations, and these are really the goals we should all work towards.
To make a better world.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
One of them is.
Yeah, and I think zero hunger is an important one. And it was already mentioned the sugar tax, so we have a negative image in the Western world. Of course, in moderation, there's no problem with sugar, and you can also enjoy life by eating it. But I think this is nice to see.
Oh, you brought me a present too, big bag.
This is your present.
50 kilo.
It's 50 kilos.
50 kilo bag of sugar.
I'm really strong.
In
so
crisis
this is
areas.
What is it?
It's for the World Food Program.
Yeah.
And Limaco assures that it goes to these crisis areas via the World Food Program, for example. But you can see that sugar is really a good substance to assure that they have enough caloric intake.
I'm going to put it down.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so back down here you say, well, sugar consumption may go down a bit because we want to eat more healthy, which is also one of the development goals. But there is parts in the world where they really need calories, and they are very happy with big bags.
Well, indeed, it has a great shelf life, of course, so you can use it for a long time. It's easily transported. So, I think that's a very nice aspect of sugar. Yeah. And well, if we continue with the sustainable development goals, for example, clean water. So we even use the water in the sugar beet. We purify that, we store it underground, and we use it in the surrounding greenhouses. So I think that's also a very nice application. Well, innovation was mentioned, and I think affordable and clean energy. We make bioethanol, for example, in our factory in Germany, which is used to in cars, for example, but also in hand gels, what Paul mentioned. And in Holland, we are the biggest producer of green gas. And we also use that in our own trucks.
Okay.
So they drive on 100% own produced green gas.
And when you're producing that green gas, we have a question on that. You're producing quite a lot. You mentioned it. It was first thing you mentioned, Paul, when you said we're not the only doing sugar. So I'm guessing green gas is also very important. And the question you guys can answer right now at home in the on the bottom of your screen is, our total green gas production can meet the needs of how many households? So how many households, if we would send all the green gas to households and to energy to be used to make a cup of tea, then how many households would benefit from that? I gave the answer a little bit. I said it was a tiny
small village or
a bigger one.
Yeah.
And you're going to give us the exact amount in a bit. Is it lower than 5,000, between 5,000 and 15,000, between 15 and 25, or more than 25,000?
Yeah, and maybe it's nicer to mention that one of the applications for which we use the green gas is for our transport. So you can see here on the screen a truck that completely runs on biogas. And it's very nice how you can see that you develop such a truck together, of course, with companies like Iveco, Scania. So you work together on improving sustainability matters.
How many of these trucks are driving around?
17.
17?
Yeah.
And they only used it. Yeah.
Yep.
It's either this or something else. Yeah. Okay. What's going on in the poll? And I don't know. I'm going to ask Paul in a bit. But you guys, we need you at home to be talking to Paul, asking him questions. And of course, also put questions forward that we can put to Andries.
I have a question, Andries. Yeah. Do we also have biosugar available?
Biosugar? At this moment not, but we are working on that. So we have projects to look into biological sugar or ecological. So I think it's nice to have that in our portfolio as well. But with that said, I also would like to mention that it's not necessarily more sustainable. So for example, hey, you don't use crop protection, but on the other hand, the yield is less, so the carbon footprint is higher. And also land use will be bigger because you have more losses.
So those two don't always go together?
No, it doesn't always go hand in hand. It depends what you look at. Probably if you look at biodiversity, ecological sugar scores a bit better. But in the end, I think it goes towards the same direction.
If you look at carbon footprint, then our normal sugar will score better. So if you want to prevent climate change, normal sugar is better, but if you were looking at other environmental aspects, then bio or eco sugar is better. Yeah.
But do you feel you have to make a choice there?
No, because at Cosan Beet Company in Germany, we are working on the eco or bio sugar, so we will have that available. And at the moment, we also represent producers from Latin America, where we import also bio sugar for our customers in Europe.
Okay,
yeah.
So you can do, you end up doing both. Let's move on.
Yeah, so this to mention that you mostly on sustainability projects, you can do a lot alone, but actually you can do more, especially the bigger challenges, if you work together.
Yeah.
And that's why we have...
Because most of the challenges, we all have the same challenges.
Exactly.
So it makes sense to work together.
Yeah, exactly. And there's a certain overlap, of course. So different stakeholders have different ambitions, but there's always overlap, especially with sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
So we signed a covenant together with the province of North Brabant, so the local government, and Naturalis Biodiversity Center to see, okay...
Maybe internationally not everybody knows.
Yeah, it's a knowledge institution, also a museum, and they have a lot of scientists working on biodiversity, on how to improve nature fields, etc., the landscape, and also agriculture.
So you sat down with them and you said, guys, what we're going to do, let's take a boat. What happens?
Exactly. we do that with more stakeholders. Eh? So they are our core partners. But of course, we work with a lot of different stakeholders. And we have five themes. Mm-hmm. So we have circular agriculture. But we also have a circle called logistics. And my colleague Arno Huismans really worked on this a lot together with some other parties. And now they said, okay, we want to transport sugar beets also by boat. And this reduces also emissions. And also, 4 kilometers on the roads are spared.
Yeah.
So I think that's a very nice pilot study. And of course, we're going to extend that and see
so
in the end.
So how many boats?
This was for one campaign and several boats.
It's about 40, 50 trucks in one boat.
Yeah. Oh, that's a lot. So why I saw one question coming by. When will it be that there's only all your trucks are on green gas, and maybe let's add the boats as well.
Yeah, so well, that might take a while, huh? Because we still have a big challenge. So we do have the technology now, and they already run the sugar to the customers, but we also have the sugar beets, and most of the sugar beets still go by truck, and they go on diesel. So in the end, we also want to change that and go to renewable energy sources.
So the beets will have to get on the boat?
Yeah, and emissionless boats in the future.
Okay.
So those are the plans.
A road ahead and some more time to go.
Yeah.
Paul, the chat.
Two questions.
Who's the lucky one?
Yeah. To mention, one is genetically modified sugar beet an innovation opportunity or a threat?
That's a good one.
Well, I would say it would be an opportunity. It's very hard in the European Union. There's a lot of legislation that makes it really hard to do so. But I think especially if you want to feed the world and if you want to reduce crop protection agents, and also to play into, like, for example, hotter summers, less rain, then I think it's a really good solution if we could see what we can achieve with genetics.
Yeah. What are the people who think it's a threat afraid of?
Well, maybe an ethical dilemma.
Image, it has to do with in the past, gene pools from tomato, for example, you could put into sugar beet or into wheat or whatever. Mm-hmm. But now we're looking more and more into only use the gene pool of sugar beet and help nature a little bit with the genetic modification within the sugar beet gene pool. And then it's less of a problem for
this
the
legislation moving that in the direction
in this
want?
Direction, yes. Yeah. And then it could help. Because consumers or we as citizens want all no pesticides, sustainable, enough food. Yeah, all we can maybe only achieve through what we call Casper CRISP, which is the new gene modification type of technique at the moment. So that would help a lot if the European Union would allow this new technique.
What are you? If you would have to guess, will it be possible in a couple of years or a decade? Or
I think the consumer gets more and more educated, also maybe because of COVID. In medicine world, I think 90% of the medicines we take are nowadays, the new medicines are all gene modified. Yeah. So people also get used to the idea that the genetic modification is a help and is saving lives. And in the future, we'll also save the planet, maybe.
Okay, you guys are positive. That's absolutely clear to me. Other things.
Yeah.
This working together. What
exactly.
Other projects.
Well, I think it's nice of this way of working together. It's like you work bottom up. So it's not that we have an assignment and we say, okay, we want you to do this.
Problem, you solve it.
Exactly. But we go on a table and we look together, bottom up. Okay, guys, where can we find each other on sustainability and what shall we do? So I think this is really a nice method. And we also have coaches that work on the process.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is how this is necessary to tackle the bigger issues we have.
Yeah. Give me another one.
We've seen we'll get another one.
Yeah.
It's called the Nature Field.
Yeah.
And this is an experiment we also did with a lot of different participants. So we have knowledge institutions that look into the biodiversity, the nature, and it's strip cropping. So you have not one monoculture, but you have different crops. 6 meters wide
in one
together.
Field.
Yeah.
Like what would typically be next to the beets?
Potatoes.
Chicory
roots. Could be a lot of things. But there are 10 different types of crops.
And what's the hypothesis? Do we think will come out?
Yeah. Well, apart from those crops, you also have land with flora that attracts natural predators. So the idea is that these natural predators, they hunt down the parasites, etc., and you use less crop protection agents, and also that the small fields can reduce the spread of disease if you have those.
Less agents, less parasites, and less disease.
Yeah, and of course, what's really important that we can also have enough yield and that the farmer can also earn enough money. Yeah, that's a very important thing.
Otherwise, he says, this way we're not going to be successful.
Doesn't work.
Yeah. Because that's also part of sustainability. Yeah?
But are you saying the same amount of money can be earned with it, or are you saying
well,
maybe
we hope
probably
so.
Even
we
more?
Hope. We hope
No, no, no. We hope, of course, that the same amount can be earned, and preferably more even.
But is it more expensive to do it this way?
Oh, at this moment, because also you need to adjust the machinery. It's an experiment, so every year, it's a 7-year experiment. This is the first year. So, of course, we make adjustments to improve.
Yeah. And the big scale is gone.
Exactly, and it still has to prove itself. So we really want to...
New techniques help. This, for example, especially is possible because of GPS on the equipment. Because if you have such small lanes, how are you going to harvest?
Yeah.
Then you go back to your GPS where you planted the material. Yeah. So then it's much easier to...
Okay,
exactly.
So it's easier now than maybe 10 years ago. Are growers enthusiastic about it? There's hardly any growers in the audience right now, so you can...
For growers, it's an experiment, so growers will not start this tomorrow. You have to convince growers that this, in the future, and that still has to be proven, is a better technique.
Yeah.
And if you can show that to a grower and that he also can earn a living with it, then he will do it.
Okay.
Yeah. So also the consumer has to help a little bit, maybe by
pushing it. Or
paying a little bit more for these products.
Okay, that's exactly. Always a problem. We have to go back to the question. We still owe people at home an answer. I'm going to have a look at the results. So our total green gas production can meet the needs of how many households? And the right answer is?
20,000, so answer C.
Answer C. And 60% of you guys at home guessed that right, or didn't guess, but knew. That's probably very nice.
And it's fed on the public net. So people living in the area of the sugar factory, they bake their eggs on our green gas.
But right now you are using most of it yourself in the trucks?
Actually, part is used in the trucks, but also for the larger part on the public net. It's also because it's made year round, and also in our own process. So we have multiple purposes for it.
Okay, good. Yeah. I think you have another slide for us, don't you? I think we were talking about consumers. You need consumers and you need clients
exactly.
to be enthusiastic, to be able
Yeah, and
Sometimes
I think it should be
more,
in the whole chain. And I think I'm very happy also that all the customers, they're also really busy with sustainability. And I can only encourage that. And I'm happy to see that they set goals and they put the bar high.
Yeah.
But I just want to show this shortly, that we also have the certifications for it. So we have EcoVadis Platina, top 1% of participating companies in this sector. And
worldwide?
Also, yeah.
And what do they ask your customers?
For business ethicals, but of course environmental footprint, those kind of things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you end up in the top 1%.
Yeah. So it's the highest score possible. So
okay. That's how we do it.
I'm proud of it.
I can imagine. Yeah.
And at the same time, 100% of our farmers, and they did really well. They have FSA Gold, and that's the Farm Sustainability Assessment. Yes, I'm also happy to say that, and that all the efforts really work, and they do a tremendous job.
Top 1%, we can't improve it. Otherwise, I would ask people at home. I know there's a lot of customers watching, and I would say, what else can they do to get a better score? But it's probably
We have a lot of challenges still. So
You can put it in the chat. What else can they do to get a better score?
Yeah.
Are there some more questions we should dive into?
With the pressure on the use of neonics and the high prices of grain, how do you see the growers' view of the beet in the future? Is your farming community enthusiastic about beet growing?
I'm trying to grasp this question.
Yes.
So there's something, pesticides are used?
Not anymore.
Not anymore, okay.
So it becomes more difficult to earn a living from beet growing.
Okay, I get it.
This is kind of a sustainability question. I think and believe that if we are able to move to other applications and new products from sugar, we can sure make a better living or a better price for sugar beet.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at the crop itself, so what the farmer is doing, in the future we will have less pesticides, but there will also be available new techniques, to my opinion. if it is robots, mechanization.
How will robots...
For example, you already see robots in the field who are taking away the weeds mechanically. So very light equipment which is driving through the fields with a solar panel and
so not
removing.
Killing it with pesticides, but just taking it out.
And this all takes time. Mm-hmm. So that's the disadvantage, and I'm understand the farmer that at the moment he has not enough tools. That's also the problem with politics. Often something disappears overnight. Overnight, they take away pesticides, for example, and the farmer and we and also the industry, etc., has to develop new tools, but that takes time.
But are you also involved in making these robots or?
No,
no. Okay,
we are not involved in making those robots.
As long as you can't make them out of beet, you won't be making them.
This also shows that you need multiple organizations. Exactly. So in the subcircle. Circular agriculture, for sure, we also invest in this and we will have a look into this, so what we can achieve with mechanical weeding.
By, for example, consulting your farmers and asking them what you need.
Yeah, inviting these companies that produce them and see what can happen. And of course, those things are not done by tomorrow, but if you never start, it never happens. So.
At the moment, I think the one who wrote this is correct. It is a struggle. Beet prices in Europe in general are low, so there are farmers which are really thinking about why should I continue. And in the Netherlands we maybe pay the highest price for beet in Europe, but also here we have the question, can we keep beet an interesting crop for the farmer? Yeah. So that all has to do with a normal earning for the beets.
Yeah, because you can be the best. But if you don't get the money to keep developing.
Correct.
Yeah.
So also for us, a challenge.
A challenge. I see another question here that I think is a very interesting one. Are the new developments unique? So I asked you how unique is a beet as compared to a potato. But you as a company, is this unique or are you just following the trends?
I think we were one of the first sugar companies with green gas on this big scale. On the use for paper now, that it's new. Beet pulp in paper is really a new development which nobody has done before. And there are more things to come where we will be the front runner.
Okay.
But I cannot tell exactly what products or etc., because we want to keep a competitive advantage over our competitors.
I was thinking you cannot tell because you don't know, but you do have a guess.
For example, the protein out of the beet leaves is also something. We are the only company in the world working on that.
So paper and something else instead of this chicken protein.
Yeah, the beet protein.
And so when it comes to the paper or competing with wood in paper, there's no competition?
There is at the moment nobody in the sugar world, the traditional competitors of ours, who have thought of this idea or who have developed this idea into business.
No, but I don't care if you have to compete with the sugar world or somebody else, if there's a better alternative.
But if you don't have sugar beets, you don't make sugar beet pulp.
No, but...
Yeah, you need the raw material.
To add to that, Crown van Gelder looked into several crops to see, okay, what's the best alternative?
That's what I mean. Crown van Gelder doesn't care if it's sugar or anything else.
But sugar beet by far came out first as most sustainable.
Okay. So you're ahead there. We know now what you are ahead of, and then you won't tell us the rest.
Yeah, and another example, like that, by the way, the 100% green gas trucks, I never saw that before either, to carry such a weight.
Okay. If there's any suggestions that maybe you have that they should
that's always nice.
Dive into with their sugar beets, then obviously please put them in the chat. Great, thank you so much. I was going to ask you, so what are the big developments that we can expect in the years to come? He's not telling us.
All right. Well,
what's your breakthrough going to be?
Well, I said before, I really wish I had a time machine to look into the year 2050 to see what's going on then. Unfortunately, that's impossible, but I'm really curious what other developments come from the sugar beet, and especially all the bio-based applications. I think there's a lot to come. And if you look at the possibilities from the sugar beet, that's more or less endless. So yeah, I think there's a really nice way ahead of us.
So if you meet other sustainability managers in different sectors and everything, do they take you seriously?
Well,
but I mean, are they like, oh, the sugar beet, yeah, you, that small play, that's not, or are they like, oh my God, you guys can be so big?
Well, I'm happy, and of course, these are the efforts of all the farmers, the colleagues, the parties we work with together. We always say sustainability and cooperation is really in our DNA. And I think I'm always proud to be able to show so much nice examples.
Yeah.
So, and they really see this, that how nice. Yeah.
And, but they also see that you can really make an impact, that it's big enough.
Yeah. And we're happy to have this crop, which is.
She is too.
Yes, she is.
And we have to do it brief, but if you could look. Could go to 2050.
Yeah.
What would be the first thing you were going to be looking to?
Actually, I want to see how the energy system is arranged.
Yeah.
But also how the agri-food sector operates
in general. You would be interested to see if we would be using beet or.
Well, I guess we will use beet. Okay. I think really with all the problems ahead, you need such efficient crops as the sugar beet.
Okay. So, not your big, that's something you have in your sleeve, we would say in Dutch, your big trick that you're going to surprise your competitors with, but anything else you really hope to see happening in the next 2 years?
In the next 2 years, I would be very proud if we realize one of these projects into the decision to build a factory for it.
Okay, so really you have all these projects playing chess on different boards.
Yeah.
One of them should really go to the next phase.
Yes.
As in building a factory.
Yeah.
And you're not going to tell us which one you think it is.
No.
That's a pity. But it's totally understandable, though. I think we're, unless you say, no, stop, there's something happening in the chat that we really have to do now.
Well, again. Your present is still here.
Oh, yes. Yeah, everybody brought me something.
So I also have to do this. We talked about biodiversity. Well, this is just some flower seeds, which you can sow. And we distribute this to all the colleagues of COSEN to say, okay, put this in your garden. It's good for the bee habitat. And of course, we also do this on a larger scale in agriculture, but especially at our production facilities. And we work together with universities so that they can advise us, okay, what's the best spot to put these seeds and attract bees.
So biodiversity is
it's an important topic, absolutely.
Okay. Thank you guys so much for watching us, you guys for being here, of course. And there's a big surprise coming up. That's going to be the next time you really hear, well, probably earlier, from COSEN Beet Company. But in autumn, there will be the Bright Beet book that's being produced right now. Can you tell us quickly what that is about? What can you see in the Bright Beet book?
Yeah, the Bright Beet book is, I would almost call it the Beet Bible. It's going into all of the applications that we have for beet and for sugar. So it will be a very thorough, complete list of all applications of beet and sugar beet.
A list like an encyclopedia or a nice picture?
Nice pictures, of course. And you can imagine, of course, not only, I would say, the known ones. Everybody knows, of course, soft drinks and sweets and biscuits and pastry. But really,
very surprising
applications of, I never thought they would use sugar there.
Okay, and it's going to be a really beautiful book. And if you put, there's a little button on the top of your screen, I think it's blue, you can there, if you click it and leave your details, then we will keep you posted on the Bright Beet book. And
probably you will get an e-version.
Yeah.
To keep it also sustainable.
Yeah, no, we're not posting it to you. We will keep you posted. In an e-book form. You will hear about it. Thank you so much for being with us here. You can still use the chat and leave anything there that you would like to share with us. Put your questions forward. Share with us what you thought was most exciting you heard here today. Thank you for being with us and hope to see you live next time.